ICTR based in Arusha and with the conclusion of proceedings this month in the case of Augustine Girabatuari, the Arusha tribunal, after some 17 years and after dealing with some, concluding some 72 cases, has finished the trial phase of its program. That's a significant development. We have no more trials to do. And all we are focusing on now is dealing with the appeals which have arisen from those trials. We expect that the appeals themselves will conclude towards the end of next year, and latest, in 2014. Closer related to that, and I think what also helped in the conclusion of the trials is the fact that we were able, during this past year, to secure the approval of the judges for the referral of cases to Rwanda for the first time. There has been an ongoing attempt to do that, and each time the judges declined for various reasons. But as a result of some law reform and capacity building which was carried out within the Rwandan legal system, we were able to finally convince the judges that the Rwandan legal system can provide fair trial opportunities. And so they have transferred a number of cases to that jurisdiction for trial. The second important development is the fact that as we are moving towards closure, the Security Council has decided that there should be a successor mechanism to the Yugoslav tribunal and to the Arusha tribunal. And so it, by a resolution passed in December last year, 1966, the number resolution, the Security Council requested our tribunal and the ICTY to work towards the establishment of that residual mechanism by 1st July. We've succeeded and managed to get the residual mechanism off the ground since 1st of July this year, at least the Arusha part of it. So it is functioning now, and the Yugoslav branch is expected to commence 1st July of next year. So there is a successor institution now in place to take over the residual functions of both the ICTY and the ICTR. Those have been, I think, our major I'd say, if you'll permit me, that we had two very important
decisions.
I've already alluded to one of them, which is the decision by our judges to refer 8 cases to Rwanda for trial, including cases of two detainees. In doing so, the judges went to great lengths to really explain what are the requirements for fair trial, what they would be looking for in order to satisfy themselves that whether a particular legal system would provide the fair trial for an accused person. The cases, the decisions are very important in many respects. First, they've enabled us to finish our work by moving some of the workload from our own court. Secondly, the cases are important because they've also now enabled other jurisdictions which were in a situation where they could not prosecute or even extradite suspected genocidaires within their own countries. Now to be able to extradite them in Rwanda. Once the ICTR gave the go ahead, the green light that the legal system in Rwanda can provide fair trial. Since then, a number of jurisdictions in Europe, in the United States, in Canada, have been able to send suspected genocidaires to that country for trial. So the gaps in impunity, in combating impunity, have been blocked to that extent, that you no longer have a situation where some of these people will find safe havens in countries which will not extradite or prosecute. I think the decisions are important also in that respect for the ICC, because I think they provide a pointer as to what needs to be done if you are going to implement complementarity. What are the reform and capacity building measures you need to resort to in order to make sure that a particular legal system satisfies the conditions for fair trial. So it's been a good series of decisions for us. Then we had the Karamera judgment also, which involved the prosecution of two of the leaders of the then ruling party at the time of the genocide in Rwanda. The UN report, as you recall, on the genocide in Rwanda did highlight the fact that sexual violence was a major weapon of the genocidaires, and that up to 250,000 women may have been subjected to it during those 100 days. We did indict these two leading personalities, leaders of the MRND, with sexual violence, with rape, not as direct perpetrators, but based on the evidence that the Interahamwe, which is the militia wing of the ruling party, was the main body responsible for the killings and the violence. And it was good to see the judges of the trial chamber agreeing and convicting these two leaders of the ruling party for rape and sexual violence committed by members of the ruling party in Delhi on the basis that they should have foreseen, the leadership should have foreseen that sexual violence would be a natural consequence of the genocide which they had conspired and planned and implemented. It's been a good decision for the struggle against rape and sexual violence to have these two leaders of the ruling party who had nothing practical, I mean they were not engaging acts themselves, but they have been held legally responsible by the government for all acts of rape and sexual violence committed and been sentenced to life for that. I think one of the challenges that the ad hocs have, not just the ICTR, is to make sure that they do pass on a legacy to succeeding generations who will be involved in the investigation and prosecution of these right types of crimes. And collectively, as prosecutors in 2006, we decided that maybe one of the best ways to do this is for us to try and document the best practices for the investigation and prosecution of these kinds of offenses. All aspects of it. What are the do's and the don'ts, what have been the successes, what have been the challenges, what have been the failures. With the help of our staff, we have now an almost final draft manual of best practices in this particular area, which should be applied for national prosecuting authorities, for international prosecutors, but more particularly for the ICC. ICC, which is just coming now into the area, could benefit from our successes and our not so successes as well, and some of the difficulties that we've had. This will cover, as I said, all aspects of our work, and we hope to actually adopt the best practices manual in November, at a meeting in Bangkok in November, and then it will then become available to the ICC and all others in the field. But speaking specifically about the ICTR and the residual mechanism, we do have challenges, of course. Even though we've now concluded the trials of more than 70 accused persons for genocide and related crimes, we still have three top-level fugitives who are alive, and that's a major challenge for us, or for the residual mechanism, because we've passed those files from the ICTR to the residual mechanism. And it's the task of that mechanism now to track them and make sure they're arrested and brought to justice. There's good information about their whereabouts. It's Kenya for Kabuga, it's Zimbabwe for Piranha. Bizimana is in the situation that where he has currently two graves situated in two different countries. And following reports that he had died. And of course, the story is not very credible, so we have to track him as well. But that's a major challenge. And neither Kenya nor Zimbabwe is being very cooperative. And we continue to hope that the Security Council and some of the big actors on the international scene will put enough pressure on them for them to collaborate with us to make sure that these people are brought to justice. Part of the work of the mechanism also, of course, is passing on the archives. I mean, there is enormous documentation created in the process of these trials. It's estimated that, for instance, for the ICTR, we will have some 2,000 linear meters of documents. That's like 2 miles of documents in some 15,000 boxes, etc. And all this has to be sorted out. We have to decide what should be retained, what should be destroyed, what should be retained under what conditions of confidentiality, who have access to it, bearing in mind the need to protect witnesses on the one hand, and also the need to provide avenues for researchers. Access for researchers and also access for national prosecuting authorities who may want to access our database. So that's one of the tasks which is actually keeping us very, very much busy at the moment.